Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, and to the World Leadership Alliance Club de Madrid, and on behalf of my colleagues at Friedrich-Ebert Stiftung, FES, thank you for the honor of inviting us to lead this working group on social justice and inclusion. My name's Sarah Burke, and I'll be your moderator for today's side event to the 59th Commission for Social Development. Our theme today is transforming multilateralism for social justice and inclusion. 2 years ago, we convened a group of representatives from civil society gathered for the commission to understand whether there was a similar appetite to mark the 25th anniversary of the 1995 Copenhagen summit as we were seeing for the Beijing summit or for the same year and also for the UN's 75th anniversary. There was little appetite at the time, but COVID has given new urgency to social development and our working group embraced the challenge. We'd like to share some key messages from the working group, so I'm excited to get started. But first, I want to let you know that you can write your questions for the speakers in the chat, and we'll have a Q&A at the end. Now I would like to invite Michael Broning, head of our FES office in New York, to offer some welcome remarks and perspectives. Michael, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Sarah, and I'm very pleased to welcome you to this joint site event to the 59th Commission for Social Development. And it's my pleasure to open this session because the Friedrich-Ebert Stiftung, as the think tank of the German Social Democratic Party, has had such a long history of engagement with the Commission. Our cooperation started back in 1995, and we've had the pleasure to cooperate with the CSO Forum every single year ever since. So in a way, it's business as usual, but of course, this year, nothing is business as usual. And while you might be tempted to say, well, same procedure as every year, it's clear that this year is anything but normal. This year is unlike any other year, which is why I've been really looking forward to following the debate today. And it's my conviction that the events that we have seen unfolding ever since the outbreak of the pandemic have really underscored the need for global cooperation, for global coordination, to find a way out of this predicament. I mean, to find a way out, we will have to do this together, that's clear. With this side event, Club de Madrid, the Friedrich-Ebert Stiftung, and the NGO Committee for Social Development would like to share, as Sarah mentioned, the working group's recommendations with a broader community of global stakeholders. The idea, of course, being to build momentum around the call for global compact on social development. Now, speaking as a social democrat, what is crucial here to me, or particularly crucial, is this idea of people-centered solutions. To me, this notion is so important because I feel that despite all eagerness to build back better, and despite perhaps also some intellectual excitement to use this crisis as an opportunity, we should never forget one thing. We should never forget that for most people, in most places, most of the time, the pandemic has not been a time of opportunity, but one of misfortune, calamity, and distress. Now, to change this and to change the underlying injustices that have become highlighted once again in this pandemic, it's up to us, it's up to the international community, it's up to governments, it's up to civil society to do everything we can to strengthen a truly responsive multilateral system. Now, with this, I would like to thank you once again for your participation in today's event. I would like to extend my thanks to our esteemed panelists for taking the time and for sharing their expertise and their input. And I'm very much looking forward to this exchange and debate. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Michael. Next, I would like to introduce Sharon Burrow, General Secretary of the International Trade Union Confederation, ITUC, and a member of the Working Group on Social Justice and Inclusion. Sharon, it would be great if you could share some of the outcomes of the Working Group and also how they might support and amplify the goals of ITUC in 2021.
So first of all, thank you very much. And it's a delight to be with all of you. I want to thank the commission that actually set up, you know, under the auspice of the Club of Madrid, this discussion, because we already had a convergence of crises before COVID-19. We had massive inequality in the world. We had the climate crisis. People were on the streets with anger and despair because they couldn't make ends meet. Trust in democracy was at a low point and remained so. and trust in globalization was broken. So multilateralism was in trouble for more reasons than that, but in summary, that's where we are. And of course, there was the climate crisis where, you know, we were seeing a real fear of insecurity generated by what is an imperative to actually transition. And so hence our call for jobs and just transition that actually will meet the test. But this working group was really, really interesting. For those of us who were privileged to be part of it, three things I would say. One, there was a convergence of understanding of the state of distrust, and B, the consequences both social and economic, and also a convergence of ideas about how if we didn't deal with inequality, with climate, and indeed with technology and exclusion in the current environment, then we were going to have more of the same. There's no doubt that we are not yet at a point where there is a global understanding of just how we have to reform multilateralism. And that in itself is going to continue to be a very deep distraction and won't help us to rebuild trust unless we can have governments, civil society, ourselves, employers, all committing to indeed what we would call a new social contract, but to a social floor that gives people hope. So very quickly, in terms of inequality, I would put it in this context, but the recommendations are common from everybody. We already have a broken global labour market. When 60% of the world's workers are indeed in the informal economy, no rights, no social protection, no rule of law, no compliance, and 94% of our workers in supply chains are a hidden workforce for whom nobody takes responsibility up the tiers of contracting, then we know that the low wage base of the profits of globalization has actually condemned the global model because of the impact on working people and their families. When you add to that the fact that 75% of the world's people have little or no social protection, and COVID-19 simply laid bare the underfunding of health and other critical care services, plus the fact that there's no income support for the majority of people, around 1.6 billion workers in the informal economy actually face destitution on a daily basis, then universal social protection, an old agenda for many of us, but universal social protection is still the resilience foundation for a future. And indeed, we would want to see global solidarity where the global countries actually come together to fund the poorest countries to actually establish universal systems. Debt relief is well canvassed, and indeed we may have issues around some of the conditionality of the IMF, Kristalina Georgieva has in fact been a great leader on calling for debt relief, for debt workout mechanism, for indeed the special drawing rights that would allow liquidity swaps, and we support that and more. Ultimately, the world's going to have to come to terms with creating fiscal space across a range of tiers, but one of them is debt relief for the most for the poorest of countries. Of course, we recommend universal public health systems. What COVID-19 shown, if you exclude people from healthcare, then not only do you impact the individual and their families, but you impact society and economies, because this virus shows that it doesn't recognise tribes or herds or country borders, and indeed neither should we. That's playing out now, of course, in also universal vaccine and the fights we're all committed to against vaccine nationalism. You must have a rights-based approach to social policies if you're going to reduce poverty and inequality. This was best laid out in a rights frame in the ILO Centenary Declaration, where the commitment from employers, workers, and governments was a floor of rights for all workers, irrespective of the employment arrangement, which guaranteed the fundamental rights, occupational health and safety, so vital and so much laid bare by this crisis. A minimum living wage or adequate minimum wage, so evidence-based, people can live with dignity in line with the ILO constitution, and of course the standard, and then of course some control over working lives in this explosion of telework and demand, not to mention exploitation more generally through our dehumanizing supply chains. When you look at indeed at the tax, how do you fund this? Then we would say it simply, tax, not austerity. We cannot go back to an austerity model, but the recommendations are very clear about the sorts of tax measures, from a corporate income tax at the floor level to looking at digital tax, indeed, potentially billionaires or wealth taxes. There's a lot of debate going on, and the committee was very conscious of that. We also need, of course, to stop those illicit flows. They've been there. We all lament them. They've all been exposed. But let's actually do something about that. And, of course, tax evasion and lack of transparency that will help us in some of the corporate corruption and impunity that goes with that. I would say you need to read it, but we see key actors, clearly the G20. Clearly the other international institutions, governments in whatever form that actually look at how we can influence the decisions of the multilateral environment, because all governments are making a joint commitment to these things. But the G20 and the G7 this year certainly have a capacity to act in leadership, and we would actually ask them to do so. We do need to look at the empirical evidence and to deepen our capacity for research, not based on old assumptions and old models. And indeed, we would like to see a new version of the World Social Summit, but with a look to really have, from my perspective, have a deep look at whether or not we need vast reform on the multilateral system. What it was actually created through the Bretton Woods institutions and some of the UN agencies was already a compromise in terms of where the thinking was post-World War II, two wars, a Great Depression, the need for a social and a rights-based floor. And now we need to come back with the added areas of crisis that we are dealing with in convergence, but with people at the centre. From an ITUC perspective, I can sum this up in five simple demands. We want a new social contract for recovery and resilience based around the demands of workers. One, jobs, jobs and jobs, climate-friendly jobs with just transition. A rights floor for all workers. Let's end the dehumanizing model of economy based on those exploitative supply chains. And indeed, the ILO centenary, as I said, lays the foundations for that. Universal social protection, with the solidarity of a global social protection fund, however we actually build that funding, set of funding layers to help the poorest countries, equality, income, gender, race. It's time. We are one world. And therefore, let's build inclusion, an inclusive future with the foundations of peace, as we're all dealing with yet another coup, this time in Myanmar, and the violence and the oppression of the military. Let's put this world back on a peaceful, democratic, rights-based trust where we have also a fair and inclusive development model. That is the sustainable development goals. 2015, the world's leaders made us all an incredible promise. One was the SDGs, and the other one was, in fact, the Paris Climate Agreement. This is how we would build a future that's based on zero poverty and zero carbon. Now's the time to put that in action. So the SDGs, a climate transition that gets us to a stable future for human beings on this planet, and of course, for working people and their families, a new social contract. thank you to the Club of Madrid, but thank you to the working group. And I hope everybody reads this and can endorse the recommendations, which I think are frankly common sense about the platform for a just future we need.
Thank you so much, Sharon, for your very inspirational words and for demonstrating the convergence of important agendas and how it's really necessary that we all bring them together and find the common ground. I am honored now to introduce the two participants in our dialogue panel discussion, part of the discussion today. First, I'd like to introduce Club de Madrid president, Danilo Turk, who was president of Slovenia from 2007 to 2012, was UN Undersecretary General from 2000 to 2005, and ambassador from Slovenia to the United Nations as well. And his counterpart in the dialogue today, I would also like to introduce Mr. Juan Somavia, was the International Labor Organization's Director General from 1999 to 2012, was president of the Preparatory Committee of the 1995 World Summit for Social Development, and ambassador to the United Nations from Chile. Sadly, we had hoped to be joined today by President Joyce Banda from Malawi, but she's mourning a recent death in her family due to COVID. So our best wishes go out to her. Gentlemen, I'd like to invite you to make a first round of remarks. And then Sharon, if you would like to join in after that, please do so. President Turk, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Sarah. And let me start by thanking Sharon Brownell for the very comprehensive and solid platform for our discussion. She has laid out the problems and a possible approach towards the future. And of course, we're living through a period of time which is not ordinary. This is an extraordinary moment in recent history, and it calls for really deep thinking and bold proposals for the future. Now, I'm saying this in light of the current work of Club de Madrid, which is an organization of former democratically elected presidents and prime ministers. We are over 100 members, and we have felt a great deal of concern when the COVID-19 emergencies started last year. We have been very active in that regard. We sent a number of letters to the decision makers in the World Bank, International Monetary Fund, in particular G20, to the European Union and others, and have pleaded. Some of those letters were signed by more than 100 members, and we were pleading for a serious redirection of policies to address the problems of the pandemic and the immediate effects, but also to create a better basis for a future global development. So we have been very active in that regard. And since we were very active, I think we can say now that we are also quite disappointed with the level of response we have seen so far. We salute Kristalina Georgieva for her valiant work, her bold proposals, her really spirit, which has to be supported. But then again, there was too little action, too little change, too little understanding in the financial institutions of the world. And that is becoming a serious concern. Now, Club de Madrid has suggested issuing additional special drawing rights as early as early April last year. Now, that was rejected in the International Monetary Fund, and nothing significant happened since. Now, this is an important symptom of a deeper malaise which still persists in the world of multilateral institutions, in particular financial institutions. The questions of debt alleviation, debt restructuring, writing off, and other measures which would be necessary given the magnitude of the problems today are also on the back burner, so it seems. And we have been disappointed with G20 in particular, but also with the institutions which depend on the leadership of G20. as well. So this is the sentiment which prevails now. Obviously, as people with experience, we do not underestimate the problems. We do not underestimate the difficulties. But we would like to be helpful and supportive of a progressive change, a change which will improve the world. When we hear concepts like Great Reset or Building Back Better or other concepts of this kind, we can't avoid the impression that we are still talking about terminological innovations rather than policy concepts. What is really meant by building back better? Now, obviously, this is not a criticism. We know that it's not easy to put together a coherent, comprehensive policy. We know that. But then again, the world should not indulge for too long in terminological innovations without serious, ambitious, and coherent policy responses. This is why we are welcoming the opportunity to be part of this discussion, which again happens in the framework of the Commission for Social Development. So we have hope that these discussions will lead to development of such a comprehensive policy for the future. And then of course one can learn from the past, and I'm very happy to be today in the company of Juan Somavia. We were both ambassadors in the 90s in New York, and Juan Somavia was a great leader for the World Social Summit, which many people didn't believe was possible at the beginning. And many believed that it was a kind of a soft policy stuff compared to the hard policy of immediate peace and security issues. Now, he was always arguing, look, social development is the hard policy, and this is where the this is on what the future of the world depends. And eventually it was possible to bring together a summit which produced a very coherent policy platform, both the declaration and plan of action. It was not perfect, of course, but it was coherent. It was human-centered, people-centered, and all the critical important elements were there, and they helped subsequently. And I know that because I worked with the United Nations in various capacities throughout that period in the articulation of the Millennium Development Goals 5 years later, and also in the Sustainable Development Goals in 2015, which are to a large extent really about social development. They are not about something else, they are about that. And if we are worried today about this hugely important and ambitious agenda of the Sustainable Development Goals and Agenda 2030, we have to think hard and clearly about what needs to be done to keep them alive and to give them new meaning in the form of credible, meaningful, and realistic social policy for the future. Just one piece of information which may be relevant in this context. Now, we learn that one of the greatest negative effects of the current crisis would happen in the area of education. 1.5 billion, 80% of children have not been in school. And that means that many are denied learning, I mean, because they don't have the capacity for distance learning. And maybe many among them will not return to school. And maybe they will end it in child labor or in some other practices. So you see, we are talking really about something that calls for urgent action. And to conclude, I would like to say, let's put our ideas together. On the occasion of the 25th anniversary of the summit, there was an event in the General Assembly of the UN where I proposed to convene a second World Social Summit sometime between now and before 2025, simply to put together a coherent set of policies in light, of course, of Agenda 2030 and Sustainable Development Goals. Because we live in the world of today. We don't want to simply repeat or simply refer to past experience. We want to talk about the new world, but we have to be inspired by the fact that in recent past, we had moments where building of coherent social policy was possible at the highest levels. So this is what I wanted to say to start our exchange with Juan and with others.
Thank you so much. And Juan, I understand that in the course of preparing for today, You may have found the birth certificate of the idea. tell us about that.
Yeah, the birth certificate is the fact that in 1990 I chaired the third committee of the General Assembly, which is the social one, and then the year afterwards the social committee of ECOSOC. And in the social committee of ECOSOC, I made timidly this idea that maybe the time had come to have a world social summit that would put people, you know, at the heart of policies, and if it worked well, would put the UN in the heart of people. That was my slogan, and that's what that was the point of departure. That happened in May 1991, and I'll come back to the summit. But I would like to get there by looking at today. I think that it was pretty clear that by the time we approved the 2030 agenda, there was a very strong disconnect of people with the elites, with the governance systems, with the prevailing power structures, with political parties. This varied from country to country, but essentially there was a feeling that, you know, there are things were not going well, and that if people were asked, who do you think the decisions are taken for, they would certainly not say decisions are concentrated on the needs that we have as the people of this country, etc. So that was already there. What the pandemic has done is to advance the urgency of dealing with this. The fact that sense of non-importance, if I can put it that way, that sense of not being asked, and if you're asked, you say thank you very much, but I'm going to do whatever I think is necessary, has obviously increased with the situation which we're today. And that is the reason why the 11 of the 17 objectives, there are 11 that are of a social nature in the 2030 agenda, become much, much, much more urgent than when they were formulated. Now, this is a today problem, and consequently, this idea of a social contract for social development, I find it absolutely essential. It's not an easy thing to do. It is a global, because it has different spheres. It has global, it has regional, it has national, and it has local. And combining all of that is not an easy question. But the key politics of it is that the political system has to give it the priority that people, they're not even demanding, are clearly needing. And that takes me to another point. I believe that probably we're pretty nearby the need of a global people's movement, of a movement that makes this uncertainty, this insecurity, this sense of, you know, being out of the picture, puts it at the forefront and say, look, we've had to organize simply to make our points clear. And that I believe that this session is discussing digital dimensions of development. I think that modern technologies permit us to organize in ways that were unthinkable in the past. So organization, people's organization are going to be essential. Why? Because this malaise, this distancing, this disconnect is obviously leading towards a weakening of the representative system of democracy. I vote, but I'm not heard. I'm told that something is going to be done, but in the end, it's not really done. It's not that nothing is being done. Lots of things are being done, but they normally fall short of my aspirations and of what I actually need. So eventually, we are already beginning to see that eventually we're going to move towards a participatory democracy, a democracy that is much more linked to the opinion of people. Not just, as I was saying before, could you please tell me what you're thinking because we're drafting a law and then the law doesn't take into account what I said. No, you participate in the genesis of the idea, in the formulation of the policy, in the implementation of the policy, in the evaluation of the policy, in the accountability of the system. So I'm highlighting that because this reference to putting people at the center of our policies is very much a contribution of the social summit. It is said in no uncertain terms in the declaration's conclusions, because this is what was felt at the time, but it was felt by governments. This is what I want to say. It didn't need much probing. Governments were obviously observing that would be, if we wanted to move, that would be a fundamental way of moving forward. I just want to make that point at this stage, because I think it's going to be a key thing. We can move forward, you know, by doing things at the multilateral level, but if we move forward, and at the national level, but if we move forward in the old style of taking decisions, in which the participation of people is weak, the problem of trust is going to be again with us. And I want to quote the Copenhagen summit on this, because they were pretty visionary. They say, we can continue to hold the trust of the people of the world only if we make their needs our priority. We know that poverty, lack of productive employment, and social integration, these were the three agenda items of the conference, are an offense to human dignity. We also know that they are negatively reinforcing and represent a waste of human resources and a manifestation of ineffectiveness in the functioning of markets and economic and social institutions and processes. It couldn't be clearer. So what does that mean? That the people that put together the social summit had the vision, had the right vision of what needed to be done. And it permeated language and it permeated action, and things happened. But certainly not to the extent that the summit had declared the need. So I would like to leave it there to say, yes, I find that it's a good idea to think about a social summit 2025. If we do that, certainly the citizens' movement is going to be necessary to be behind. But I am also certain that if you discuss this with governments today, I don't see that there's going to be much difficulty. There's going to be difficulty in what you say, but the recognition that this is at the heart of today's problems and that social policy is even more important than the effort that was made by the 2030 agenda to put it there, and that these 11 dimensions that are social need to be put together in a coherent political thinking. That's what the social summit did. So that's why the social summit is the political foundation of the social dimension of the 2030 agenda. But we need to deepen that. We need to deepen that, and I would like to say in a further intervention of why we need to deepen that.
In terms of deepening that, do we need a new values caucus? I understand that the values caucus that took its inspiration from a seminar that was hosted by the government of Slovenia back in the run-up to the first social summit brought some of the energies together. I'll put this question to both of our speakers. Do we need a new values caucus, or is there something similar right now that we can tap into?
Well, if I may say just one word about this. In the preparations for the World Social Summit, obviously, it became clear that we need a better understanding of values that actually underpin social policy and policy development, policy in general. Then nowadays, we hear a great deal of talk about values, and this has become a kind of a standard rhetorical device for many politicians. But what I find is that this talk about values today is very superficial, very shallow. It does refer to something that defines us in a kind of a superior way. Values has become something which we are proud, but we never explain what exactly they are and why are they relevant to the future. So what we now have is a really very deficient, shallow discussion which has to be changed. Now, to add a bit of a, how should I say, sense of irony into our discussion, when we convened this meeting in 1994, Slovenia was a new country, and we were really full of thinking about how our development should look in the future. So it was really genuinely coming from our needs of the time. And some of the participants who were there and who were critical, like, for example, Joseph Czerny, is now one of the cardinals who is the closest advisor of Pope Francis. He was one of the key architects and intellectual minds in that discussion back in 1994. So you see, these are kind of a basic things which have to be there. We obviously today need a very careful technically defined discussion. Clearly, of course, that's always needed when you design a policy, but that's not enough. What it needs is a kind of a values-based which binds people together in a very ambitious global project. And that is what we do not have. And I would like that to be remedied. How that can be done today, I'm not entirely sure, but the fact that we have this meeting today shows that we feel the same need and that there are people who are already doing things. So let's do more things.
Sarah, let me just quote the summit. You asked, you know, should we do something on values? The summit says, we heads of state and government are committed to a political, economic, ethical, and spiritual vision for social development based on human dignity, human rights, equality, respect, peace, democracy, mutual responsibility and cooperation, and full respect for the various religious and ethical values and cultural backgrounds of people. That's the basic value formulation of the summit. Although the summit is extremely genderized, because it's quite interesting, because there was an understanding between the Beijing summit and this summit, because we worked with the organizers of the Beijing summit and we said, look, let's advance as much as we can on gender issues in the social summit. So you don't have to give those battles. We can give some of them here, and it's extremely genderized. And then you know, you take it from there. But in this listing, we didn't put gender, which of course goes into it, but it is very much a part of the whole thing. So yes, we can look at it in today's context and ask ourselves, do we need to reinforce? But I would completely agree with Danilo. We're having light discussions. We can put things in documents, but we're having light discussions in relation to how we go about it. And I think that what we need to have consciousness is the enormous difficulty if we really want to make this happen, naturally, politically. But not only that, it's the fact that moving urgently in the manner in which we meet with social policies implies understanding the multiplicity of relationships that you have within different issues and the multi-dimensional nature of a number of things. Let me give you an example. If you're talking about actors, who are the actors involved? Well, you have the state, you have the market, you have society, you have the citizen, and you have nature. You have Earth, which expresses itself in a number of different ways according to the good or bad things that we do, which is very interesting. In the middle of the crisis, there was less production and there was less pollution. Just small detail that the crisis left with us. Those are the actors. But if you take a look at the levels, you have the multinational, the multilateral level, you have the regional, the national, the local. I mentioned the local because in this disconnect of people with politics, the local authority are the only ones that continue to have a certain legitimacy. And that again is a sort of a worldwide problem. If you take a look at policies, you have to look at the economic, the social, the environmental, the cultural. In fact, the 2030 agenda gives a very strong indication that that needs to be done. And in terms of interests, it's evident that we have some common interests, but the higher interests that are not there. So when you say, look, we have to move forward with a new social contract for social policies, or it's we have to assume also the knowledge challenge that this brings, the organizational challenge that it implies, the ideological challenge, because, you know, these types of values, if we want to say, well, we're going to, for example, let's take what the summit said and let's decide that we won't touch it, we will add gender and we move forward. You're not going to have necessarily, a general agreement to do it. You may have a general agreement for the formulation. So I want to, it's a good, very good question, Sarah, because it leads to the fact that this is essential, but it's damn difficult. But the fact that it's difficult is precisely one of the biggest stimulus for those of us who have a leg in having public responsibilities and another leg in being a civil society, actor. So I've lived both worlds. But from a civil society perspective, there's nothing more challenging than something that is difficult. Huh? And this is damn difficult. But if we begin thinking about a global movement, people's movement, I believe that one way or the other, at least the agenda of urgency can be put on the table. Now, putting my governmental hat, of course, these things are not easy. They're complicated, and moving forward is not an easy process. But again, as so many times in history, if we don't do it, the next time around that we come to discuss these matters, and if we wait for 2030 to have a real change on social issues, and say, well, sorry, we were not able to do everything, but we've done something, the something is no longer viable. Real change is absolutely necessary, and this is what the working group in which we participated in the Friedrich-Ebert Foundation was so clear about it. But yes. I'm optimistic. I think that these things are possible, that we can have the sort of tranquil discussion that makes it at the governmental level, at the multilateral level, but also at the civil society level, permits us to advance.
I am letting our meeting run a little behind, but I want to turn from these, your explanation of the depth of the challenge we face with optimism to Sharon to put in her two cents on this. And then I'd like to turn to the member state representatives who have kindly agreed to join us and offer their remarks. Sharon?
So I would never question an incredibly wise president and indeed an ambassador who I, dearly love from a whole range of years of joint work. But can I say the biggest challenge? I think if you look at the UN Declaration of Human Rights, do we still support that as a values base? I would say yes. Now maybe if there are areas that are excluded, we should look at it. Do we support the SDGs? Absolutely. It is, as you said, both said, it's a social agenda, a social commitment to the world. And do we know that multilateralism needs reform because it's not meeting this test? Yes. So what's the problem? Well, from where I sit, the problem is that you've got people and indeed leaders in the world who have in fact got us to this point with all of the, the standards, the convention, the laws. But we have a model of economy, a model of business that is operating in direct conflict with this. Why? Because if you look at the model of economy, the profits that are now incredible, through globalization, even in the last 30 years, 3-4 times the GDP, none of us believes GDP is an adequate measure of wealth, and we need to get beyond that for accountability, which is some of the things you're talking about, and rebuilding trust in democracy. But let's just take that as a wealth measure. Where is it? It hasn't been shared. People are angry. They're actually angry because of despair, not just because even of unfairness. So until we change the model of economy that allows for inclusion within and across nations with a rights and a base that actually generates a different model where fair competition is possible, then we're not going to serve the ends of values, rights, standards, policy ambitions, with a genuine commitment. They're a very good business. I work with them globally who are committed to the SDGs. But I can tell you, when the pressure's on for governments, particularly in the poorer countries, to not actually, you know, regulate a labour market, to not look after building their social protection floor because the money is demanded elsewhere, to not have the solidarity of support against the dominance of that corporate model, then people are the victims of that. So, you know, that's our challenge. How do you reconcile a model of economy that actually builds the prosperity but shares it on a base that everybody feels included around? And I would say one thing, and one Somavia knows how very hard this is to do, but if we are going to democratize our global institutions, beginning for us with the broken model of the WTO, and I'm so delighted an amazing woman like Ngozi is going to be at the helm, but what a job she has. She will need both support and an incredible help to turn this course around. But why not social dialogue at the WTO? Why not the labor and rights and environmental floor that we all want as part of a floor for fair competition? And why not mandated due diligence with the UN treaty and, of course, the EU and other countries, which actually says it shouldn't only be the good businesses, it should be all businesses that take responsibility for eliminating the risk of violations in their supply chains. We can do it. I'm optimistic too, but we've got to have the players that want to do it.
Thank you, Sharon. A lot to react to. Your Excellency, Ambassador Fernandez de Soto, very, very grateful that you were able to join us today. Very curious what your perspectives are on the discussion, on the idea of the values that need to drive this transformation. So the floor is yours.
Thank you, Sara. Thank you very much. I want to express my gratitude to the director of the Friedrich-Ebert Foundation in New York, Michael Bruning, and to the president of the Club of Madrid, Danilo Turk, and the Commission for Social Development for hosting this event on social justice, as well as for their kind invitation. I would like to prompt the efforts made by the Colombian government towards a renewed multilateralism for social inclusion and equity, especially during this time of COVID. Today, I will refer to the current global and regional scenarios. Also, I will comment on the elements to consider in the path to renew multilateralism. And finally, I will share some of the efforts made by my government in the field of social inclusion. As the political scientist Jan Brammer has pointed out, we face a triple global crisis on health, economics, and politics. It affects all of us, but it is causing enormous suffering in countries with lower development levels and to the most vulnerable population. Numbers speak for themselves. The IMF estimates that the world economy contracted by 4.4 in 2020, the worst turned down since the 1930s. As for Latin America, the ECLAT estimated GDP growth rate decreased by 9.1%. The poverty rate reached 37%, and the inequality has increased dramatically. We have lost more than a decade of development, and the region suffers from the pandemic of poverty and inequality. In this scenario, full of uncertainties and solutions, will demand time. According to Bloomberg, we could need at least 7 years at today's vaccination rates to have a return to normality. Humanized globalization and deepened collective responses are an obligation. Historically, Colombia has been an advocate for multilateralism under the premise that there are not sovereign nations able to build a future in isolation. We should take into account several factors to advance together. In the first place, we need more solidarity and cooperation. The government of Colombia has supported UN Secretary General's efforts to provide immediate responses with solidarity. We have made a call for including the COVID-19 vaccine as a global public good and to have a cost-effective health strategy. In the second place, we must strengthen international institutions to make them more efficient and transparent. Third, we need effective and democratic leadership. The world demands clear, timely, and coordinated responses. States and international institutions must show determination and take bold decisions. Four, we look forward to enhancing adaptation and preparation. States should be ready for a future crisis. According to scientists, we could face in the coming years a new pandemic that would be more harmful and dangerous. Fifth, and last, more science, technology, and innovation are fundamental to facilitate the flows of information and to boost human well-being for all. Colombia is one of the countries that has placed equity and social inclusion at the center of its development policy. Our national development plan integrates the 2030 agenda for development as an articulate axis to eliminate poverty, reduce inequalities, and promote well-being and prosperity. In the current scenario, Colombia has taken early and timely decisions to face the pandemic. Among those, diverse, effective, and multidimensional measures that seek to achieve a balance between safeguarding the health of our citizens and protecting the public health system. Those measures have stimulated a progressive recovery of productive life, welfare, and employment. As we have stated, without health, there is no development. And without development, there cannot be a sustainable health system. In this regard, we rapidly enhance social policies to protect the most vulnerable using all institutional capacities and strengthening public and private partnerships. More than 10 million families have benefited from unconditional cash transfer up to 11% of GDP. Colombia has maintained three significant programs, Families in Action, Youth in Action, and Elder Colombia. Also a new program compensating the value-added tax has reached poor population. On the multi-stakeholder approach, Colombia is of the view that it is necessary to promote new governance open to dialogue with private enterprises, social organizations, and citizens. This is one of the crucial transformations to grasp the needs of all, especially on those in the South Global. To conclude, the 2030 agenda is the roadmap that should guide the collective action on the international community. We invite you to redouble your efforts to place equality and social justice at the center of sustainable development. One of the best examples of this spirit of solidarity is the announcement by President Duque last Monday regarding the temporary protective legal status that Colombia will provide to the 1.7 million Venezuelan migrants that are living in our country. This policy allows the Venezuelan migrants to exercise legal activities and to benefit from the social protection from the state. It is a historic decision in favor of the most vulnerable. Secretary General Antonio Guterres and the international community have applauded. The UN High Commissioner for Refugees, Filippo Grandi, has considered his decision as the most important gesture in the region for decades. I believe that is the time to build more just, peaceful and democratic societies. We cannot wait any longer. The way forward is very clear. It is through multilateralism, international cooperation, and solidarity. Let me finish just expressing my gratitude to President Danilo Turk and Juan Somavia, all friends of Colombia. When I was foreign minister of my country, they play a crucial role for the peace and for the relation with the labor sector. And I cannot finish without recognizing all the support that they give us at that difficult time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador Fernandez de Soto. I really appreciate your remarks. I am bound to try to keep our discussion moving. So I would also like to invite Nuno Matias, the Deputy Permanent Representative from Portugal, to offer his remarks.
Thank you, Sarah. Thank you. Thank you all. It is a pleasure to join you today. And I want to thank the Club de Madrid for organizing this event. Now, as you know, Portugal holds during this first semester of 2021, the presidency of the Council of the European Union. So if you allow me, I will share just a few thoughts on our priorities that I believe are important for our discussion here today. So during that time when we will hold the presidency, we will concentrate on the European recovery, following the Union's strategic guidelines by strengthening our resilience on the path to lead to the twin transitions, which is climate and digital. So to achieve those objectives, Europe must rely and reinforce its social model. In order to implement the European pillar of social rights and its action plan, it will be even more necessary to overcome and respond to this unprecedented economic and social crisis, and by ensuring that the road to recovery will truly leave no one behind. Therefore, we aim at strengthening Europe's social model based on solidarity, convergence, and cohesion, capable of acting in a coordinated way and recovering from the crisis. Now, the European social model has always been at the center of the European Union's contribution to building a democratic, just, cohesive, and inclusive societies. And it was instrumental in deepening the single market, the single currency, the concept of European citizenship, and the comprehensive application of the fundamental rights. The current circumstances are decisive for the future of our countries and the future of European Union. So we have the responsibility to show our citizens, our workers, our families, and our companies that they are not alone, and that our policies and our actions are directed at fulfilling their needs, both assuaging their anxieties and helping them to pursue their dreams. The Portuguese presidency will organize a social summit on the 7th and on the 8th of May. This summit aims at providing an inclusive forum for member states, European Union institutions, social partners, and civil society to discuss how to strengthen our European social model, how to make the principles of the European pillar of social rights a reality in the life of our citizens, and to shape our road towards 2030. So as I conclude, our goal is to send a strong message to European citizens that their expectations are taken into account in public policies through the involvement of all relevant actors. Our social model is key in assuring Europeans that the climate and the digital transitions will not be a threat, but rather an opportunity. To do this, we will need to increase skills to empower citizens, invest in innovation, and strengthen social protection to ensure that no one is left behind. I thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Matias. I'd like to turn now to Maria Fornella Oninger, the co-chair of the NGO Committee on Social Development, representative of the Soroptimus International, and our partner in this endeavor. Maria, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Good morning, excellencies, distinguished guests. What a high-level panel. What a wonderful, wonderful conversation. I'd like to first thank FES and the Club of Madrid for inviting me to join this conversation today. And personally, thank Sarah Burke, who has been such a big part, such a big support during the planning of our civil society forum now underway. I'll try to gather a few thoughts together. I had planned a presentation, but I don't think I'll have time. And it's not necessary because you have really brought every topic to the table. Multilateralism or a renewed effort to multilateralism has occurred after every major event, after every watershed event, whether it is post-World War II with the framework of the United Nations and the Bretton Woods institutions, or whether it is the 1990s with the end of the Cold War and the new countries coming into being, and the summits with children and women's rights, social mobilization, children and women's rights coming to the forefront, or of course the culmination of this series of, and Beijing, of course, and the culmination of this series of summits with the Copenhagen Summit on Social Development and its declaration and program of action with putting poverty eradication, social inclusion, and full employment at the center of the of development. And they remain there today. That's our framework. That's the basis of the 11 social development goals. That's our social pillar today. I am a strong believer in multilateralism. At the same time, I understand that the pandemic has given an opportunity to renew it. But I trust the United Nations system. I think we are the ones that have failed, the leadership has failed, but the charter principles reaffirming fundamental rights, equality and dignity and the worth of a human person are still intact. So we have to renew our commitments to them. This Commission on Social Development is an example of multilateralism at work today as we speak. The proposal for a draft resolution on the priority theme is being negotiated along these days and has now gone under silence procedure, which will end tonight. But strong negotiations are going on. We have some input from the Bureau, and we see multilateralism at work every day in the Social Commission. Our contributions of the civil society on the civil society side, I think they have been important because we have brought back the topic of social protection systems. I was counting on my notes and now I don't have them anymore. Social protection systems, including floors, was a central topic of 3 years ago. Affordable housing to end world homelessness is another major principle that I think we helped push into the agenda with the help of many other actors in the world system, in the UN system. And now it's digital technology, the digital divide, digital inclusion, because we cannot ignore the fact that this fourth industrial revolution is different in scope, in speed, and in its impact on the system. So I would like to say a little bit more about digital technology, but I don't have time. So I'm just gonna say, we have to be careful with the binary view of digital technology as the panacea that is going to take care of all our inequalities and close all gaps, because in fact, it can deepen them too. For example, we're living right now a gap in vaccination. Many countries don't even have stocks available. So, and on the other hand, It could be a driver of inequality, but it could solve many problems. To solve those problems, then we have to build on human capacity. Governments need to build human capacity from the beginning. They have to have certain tools in place, governance and policies thought out, and not let the industry just run us over. And to conclude, I'd like to say that the new multilateralism that we need is to strengthen the United Nations system that has proved throughout the years that it has improved the lives of many people, depending on agency. Again, the examples of the 60s, UNCTAD, the decade of poverty, the discussion on the terms of trade and trying to bridge the North-South gaps. There is, when there is agency, and again, of course, Copenhagen and the 90s, when there is agency, there's change. We should not be discouraged by countries turning inward and attributing blame because of the pandemic. People are disoriented. What we need is a new social contract, really, to renew the commitment of governments if they want to regain the trust of civil society and their legitimacy. They need to renew a social contract based on basic needs, on meeting basic needs and on basic rights, just the rights that are in the charter. Equality, dignity, worth of the human person. So this new multilateralism, or this renewed efforts at multilateralism, must include civil society participation, not on the last day of the HLPF or of the General Assembly, but from the beginning, as the ambassador said, from the genesis of the idea to its formulation and articulation, to its implementation. Actually, so civil society, what we do best is help implementation and monitoring, but we're not involved in the first part of the process. And I leave it there, and I hope I made some contributions. I had planned for a longer presentation, but I thank you very much for the opportunity.
Maria, thank you so much for your thoughts. And I think you didn't need the presentation from the remarks that I'm reading, the questions coming in. And thank you for your kind words about our cooperation with the NGO committee. And we look forward to that going forward for many years. I've been getting bombarded with questions. I'm trying to distill them all. So if you will permit me, I'm going to kind of, people are honing in on the same kinds of things. So I'm getting questions about who will champion, who will be the champions for the idea for a new summit, and what must happen right now to seize the momentum toward that. And then once that momentum is seized, what are the next concrete steps? Reform the UN? Increase regional cooperation, have more meaningful participation by non-state actors. Others following the same line were asking about what kind of new economy we need. Do we need a green economy? Is the green economy idea green enough? And many people believe that we do need to be guided by values and that we need a renewal of values. There was a question about whether we should revise and update, modernize the Universal Declarations of Human Rights to make it fully compatible with the SDGs. And the same question is wondering what institution could be the guardian of this global summit that would house and put forward the work of such a declaration. And then finally, we have a set of comments that are concerned about how we address the inequalities that remain. One is asking about how we can deal with the world's political instabilities and still make progress on inequalities. Another's wondering if we can have a new social contract, or if we need to be thinking more particularly in terms of regional or sub-social contracts. So there's a wealth of interest and a lot of questions coming in. So what I'd like to do is to return to our main panel, first to President Turk and to Wansoma Bia and Sharon Burrow, and if we have time, and we will accept another round of questions or further comments from the other panelists. President Turk,
Yes, thank you. Well, this was quite a collection of questions, and I would like to comment on three types of questions which were raised so far. First, on human rights. I think some updating would be in order. But before that, I think we have to take a deep look into the value of the Universal Declaration itself. Now, the Universal Declaration is a very comprehensive document, and it contains the basic ideas for all major aspects of social development and political development. For example, one of the standards enunciated there is the right of everyone to the highest attainable standard of physical and mental health, which is very, of course, topical nowadays. Now, the declaration doesn't say the highest standard of you know, that everybody can go to the court and obtain health from the court. I mean, it's not that simplistic understanding of human rights. It does speak about the highest attainable standards. Now, states should be very careful in defining health systems that ensure the highest attainable standard in their circumstances. And today we see that states haven't been at that level. So I think that in the Universal Declaration as it stands today, we can find the basis for serious improvement in policy and in systems around the world. So I think that one has to preserve the fundamental importance of the Declaration and interpret it in the spirit in which it was designed. Now, of course, that doesn't mean that new elements could not be added relating to the question of sustainability of development and all that. I'm not going into details here, but of course, the Declaration was not yet fully cognizant of the problems that would arise, and there is scope for improvement. The second question, which was second type of questions which were raised, was about how to change the multilateral system, how to improve the multilateral system. Now, obviously, it would be great if we had another San Francisco moment, you know, a moment where a major redesign could take place. But let us not forget, I mean, the UN Charter has long roots. I mean, it has started with the League of Nations. There was a lot of serious work done in Washington by Washington think tanks in preparation for the Dumbarton-Oaks conference in 1944, which actually drafted the charter, and Brookings Institution was really central in that regard. So intellectual work is always helpful. But of course, you cannot expect that we'll have a San Francisco moment every few years. So one has to look into incremental changes as well. Now, Sarah Burrows mentioned the new Director General of the World Trade Organization, Gozi. And that would be it would be very interesting to see how can that moment be seized for serious reform proposals. Now, some of those proposals are necessary and timely, but not new necessarily. For example, the whole talk about social clauses in trade, that has been there before, but has not succeeded. Let's see in what form it would make sense to bring them back to the agenda. Let us not forget, when European Union negotiated with China on the comprehensive agreement on investment, international labor standards became a very important part of that. So times are changing, and maybe we can introduce new elements that really improve multilateral cooperation. And finally, let us not forget about the what we learned from Nuno Matias a short ago. European social model has to be reviewed, strengthened as the basis for recovery of European Union. Now, I would say that this is also an opportunity for global reflection on multilateral cooperation, because European Union is a significant actor and can mobilize partners across the world. And finally, on social contract, I mean, there, of course, we need to do a lot more work. And again, references were already made to tax fairness, tax havens, combating this sort of problems, which is the way to changing the currently prevailing economic model. And that, again, is there and has to be addressed It has been discussed in OECD, even in G20 and in other places, but without sufficient energy. The time has come for that energy to be brought into the picture now. So these are the kind of comments I could make at this point.
Thank you. Juan?
Thank you, Sarah. Let me follow up on what Danilo was mentioning. If we talk about leadership towards the future for a social summit, I think that we have to begin with the president of the Club de Madrid. He has been extremely strong in pushing the idea. And I believe that the role he has played in that space is extremely important. And I would see, given the fact that it's former presidents and prime ministers who can come together and say, look, this is the way we're looking at things. And that's why we have to put again social policy and social development at the heart of things. I think that would be very important. But I have to say that the participants in this panel, it's Danilo, it's Sharon and the whole movement, you know, the workers' movement. It's the Friedrich-Ebert Foundation and its capacity to operate globally. In New York, it's the NGO and social committee. I think that already here you can conceive, you know, a few ideas that can be gotten going. And on the other hand, you need the Secretary General, you need the Secretariat in New York to assume, to absorb that this is something that needs to be carried forward. In terms of values, I think I couldn't agree more with Sharon. I couldn't agree more with Sharon on what she said about the economic model. And I would just pick one part of that subject and link values to inequality. We are living in a crisis of neoliberalism, but with neoliberalism is still present in policies. And what did neoliberalism do? It overvalued the role of the market, it undervalued the role of the state, and it devalued the dignity of work and the role of public policies. So we that value structure needs to be changed around. I would refer just to one. If we take a look at work, you know, the dignity of work and the dignity that it produces for the human being was simply changed into a cost of production. So the human being at work became just a cost of production. When the human being at work means personal dignity, it means stability of families and the way people want to live together. It means peace in communities, because communities that have a good work are more peaceful. It implies citizen opinion, because the worker is also an opinion, and basically it produces more social cohesion and more democratic convivencia, you say in Spanish. I don't know what the word in English is now. So the value of work has to be at the heart of human beings, and work has to be at the heart. And the third question I would like to say is the different dimensions of social contract. In fact, I mentioned it, but I will look at it again. It's not the a global social contract. It's not a regional social contract. It's not a national social contract. It's all of that together. Different levels, different things have to be done. Because obviously the differentiation between countries pursuing the same objectives are going to be extremely different. So understanding that the global compact is a synonymous of saying, look, we need a fundamental convergence on these issues. Different interests will have to come together to make this happen. I think that point is very, very important. And finally, I want to thank my good friend Danilo, because he said very nice things about my work when we were getting the social summit going. But an experience of that process, which might be useful today. When we launched this idea in ECOSOC, the ECOSOC took a decision, which was to ask the Secretary General to consult. this is normally a procedure by which you ask the Secretary General to consult, and then you go and talk to the Secretary General and say, look, there's no water in the pool and this is not going to fly, so go ahead and do a little bit of consultation, but we don't believe that you should do this. What he did was totally contrary to that. He called me in and he said, Juan, I want to appoint you as my personal representative to do this consultation that I have been asked by ECOSOC. And I traveled all over the world representing the Secretary General and found that this issue was much more embedded in the preoccupations of countries than this sort of crazy idea that seemed crazy in the UN at that time. You know, there was a real preoccupation with that, and this is also the situation today. There's no country that can come and say, look, don't bother me with that idea. This is not really important. We have just heard that the European Union is organizing a social summit. So I believe that we have to push the UN in that direction. And that implies also in terms of the institutional question that was raised, that the manner in which the UN system works together is also going to have to change. You know, we are very compartmentalized. We also say that we do things together on this, this, and that, but in the end, there's no integrated thinking. And unless we have an integrated thinking on the different dimensions that you have to touch if we want the type of social development that we have been talking about, is enormous. That's the knowledge challenge. What does that mean? And that's a perfectly possible challenge to take up by the UN. It has the people, it has the convening power. What is integrated thinking for a new social contract on sustainable development? Big challenge for the UN.
Big challenge, thank you, Juan. And our technical staff has given me an extra 5 minutes, which we're already over. So Sharon, I'm going to ask you to try to wrap it up in a minute.
One sentence. I agree totally, indeed, with both my panelists. And a new social contract, Ron said it, it's what the people want. Now, of course, there are a set of demands for workers. There'll be a set of demands from, you know, people working or indeed women operating in care. There'll be a set of demands. We have to move beyond the concept of GDP. And government accountability at all levels, national, international, right down to the city's level, has to respond to the demands of the people. Globally, Juan said it beautifully, it needs a coherence that actually listens to the constituents and brings together the foundations we already have, but make sure they're implemented in an approach that puts people at the center of recovery, resilience, a just world, and people will have their own demands that need to be fulfilled around what makes for them the security of a new social contract. I think this is a brilliant panel. Let's see what we can do.
I love it. Let's see what we can do. Maria from the NGO committee, we agree this is one of our favorite quotes of the day. When there's agency, there's change. So that's what we need now. Thank you very much to Club de Madrid. Thank you to the NGO committee. Thank you to all the panelists and to our audience. It's been a wonderful discussion.
Thank you.
Thank you, Juan. Thank you, Danilo. Pleasure to be here.